Good evening, everyone. Marty Ramsey here, Director of Alumni Engagement. And I'd like to welcome everyone to the 20th installment of Western Wednesday. This evening's live stream program features WCU Associate Professor of History, Dr. David Dorondo, and his presentation, Russia, the West, and the War on Ukraine. During this evening's presentation, viewers will have the opportunity to submit their questions and comments using the chat feature on YouTube and Facebook. I will share your questions with Dr. Dorondo following the presentation. Next, I would like to recognize a very special guest that has tuned in with us this evening. WCU Chancellor Kelly Brown, who rarely misses a Western Wednesday, is here with us tonight. She's not visible on your screen, but she is tuned in as a participant. Thanks for being here, Chancellor Brown. Now I'd like to ask Ben Pendry, WCU's Assistant Vice Chancellor for Development, to introduce this evening's special guest. Take it away, Ben.
Thank you, Marty, and good evening, WCU alumni and friends. Thank you for joining us tonight for what has become a tremendous platform for the promotion of the high-quality scholarship and learning that takes place right here at Western Carolina University. In keeping with that theme, it is my great privilege to introduce our Western Wednesday presenter, WCU Associate Professor of History, Dr. David Dorondo. Dr. Dorondo earned the Bachelor of Arts degree with honors in history from Armstrong State College. He earned the Master's of Arts in German and European Diplomatic History from the University of South Carolina. And from 1984 to 1987, he was a member of St. Anthony's College, Oxford, and was admitted to the degree of Doctor of Philosophy from the University of Oxford in 1988. While earning his doctorate, he also served as a Fulbright Graduate Research Fellow at the University of Bamberg in the Federal Republic of Germany from 1985 to 1986. Since 1987, Dorondo has been a member of the Department of History of Western Carolina University. There, he teaches both undergraduate and graduate courses in modern European military and political history and the history of international relations. Since 1987, he has mentored thousands of history majors, and it is truly one of the great privileges of my life to be among them. He has advised wisely, he has counseled fairly, he has enforced automatic F errors, he has brought tremendous passion to his classroom, to this community, and to his students. He is a member of U.S. Strategic Command's Academic Alliance and has served as a subject matter expert for and contributor to the U.S. Joint Staff Strategic Multilayer Assessment. Since 2020, he has served as a member of the NATO Science and Technology Office's Research Task Group SAS-163, Energy Security in the Era of Hybrid Warfare. He has written or translated 4 books on modern German military and political history and has contributed to numerous journals, military encyclopedias, and periodicals. Dr. Dorondo is a member of the Pi Kappa Phi Fraternity, the Air Force Association, the North Carolina Military Historical Society, and the Society for Military History. He received WCU's Last Lecture Award for Teaching in 2012 and the College of Arts and Sciences Teaching Award for the 2000-2001 year. In 1996, he received the Medal of Scholarship from Pi Gamma Mu International Honor Society in Social Sciences. He co-founded and co-moderates WCU's Global Spotlight Series on International Affairs. He is an avid horseman. He lives below Flat Gap in the Cowie Mountains of Jackson County, North Carolina. He is my friend. He loves Western Carolina University, and I'm so excited to learn from him today. Dr. David Dorondo.
BJ, thank you very much indeed. Marty, thank you as well. I'd like to say how much I sincerely appreciate being here this evening. The subject about which we're speaking tonight is of critical importance. It's certainly the most important issue in the history of Europe since the end of the Second World War. Not accepting, I think, the reunification of Germany and the collapse of the Soviet Union. And I say that primarily due to the fact that not only is it a major war, obviously, first and foremost, but because it is a human catastrophe of unparalleled dimensions. Again, since the end of the Second World War, there are over 10 million Ukrainian refugees, according to the UNHCR, as of, I guess, 3 days ago. Approximately 6.5 million of which are internally displaced within Ukraine. So this is a human catastrophe of enormous magnitude. And it's also a fundamental challenge to what we all refer to now rather commonly as the rules-based international order. Unfortunately, many of us were surprised by this turn of events. In retrospect, I think as the history of this conflict is written, we may learn that we should not have been surprised by it, given events in the Russian government and developments in the Russian government since 1999. I think there will be a certain degree of remorse that greater attention was not paid by a greater number of persons in governments since 1999 to those actions on the part of Vladimir Putin and the Russian government. I took the liberty of bringing along some slides this evening, which I'll use as well, simply for the purpose of illustrating for our audience some of the issues about which we'll be speaking this evening. The first one that I have is a slide depicting two churches. The one that you see on the left-hand side of the slide is, of course, one which is remarkably famous and notably so, and rightly so. And, of course, it's St. Basil's Cathedral in Moscow. St. Basil's is an architectural wonder. It's a religious center of huge importance, cultural and historical and religious importance in the history of Russia. On the right-hand side of that same slide, of course, you see another church. This particular church is in Mariupol, the city on the shore of the Sea of Azov in the far south of Ukraine. This picture is about 2 weeks old. It is unclear, given the provenance of the photograph, whether the church in question, now destroyed, was an Orthodox church. The majority of Ukrainian Christians are Orthodox of one church or another. But there's also a very substantial Ukrainian Greek Catholic population of about 5 million. And the original provenance of this photo was unclear as to whether or not this was an Orthodox or a Greek Catholic church. But I think it well illustrates the catastrophe which is being visited upon Ukraine. No city in Ukraine is safe. No cultural institution in Ukraine is safe. And, of course, no civilian population center is safe either. And so I thought this, in a slide, sort of encapsulates many of the issues that that we have to deal with. By way of orientation, the map that one sees here simply is a sort of global view, if you like, of Russia. Russia is by far the largest country on this planet in terms of square mileage, not in terms of population. And if you look at that slide, you'll see that the distance from St. Petersburg in the far west of Russia to the city of Vladivostok on the Sea of Japan spans an entire continent. The distance between those two cities is nearly 6,000 miles. It's 5,882 or something like that. So not quite 6,000 miles, which is to say it's a country that spans 11 time zones. Russia has a population of about 146 million people, and of course it's a nuclear superpower. It strains credulity to think that Russia is a superpower in any other sense, material sense, but certainly insofar as the extent of the country is concerned and its nuclear weaponry is concerned, one has to take it seriously as a superpower. Whether or not it retains that reputation hereafter is another question. And that will have to be decided in the future. By dramatic contrast to the map that you see here, we have a map of Ukraine. Ukraine is the second largest country in Europe in square mileage after Russia. Ukraine has a population of 44 million and a bit. And Ukraine has been historically, for many centuries, a region and a country and a people, indeed, which have been subject to various forms of imperialism and colonialism. In the 16th and 17th centuries, it was the Commonwealth of Poland and Lithuania, which was one of the dominant powers in that part of the world where Ukraine is now located. Beginning in the 17th century, Russia began to encroach in the south. And eventually, over the course of the 18th century, Ukraine became sort of absorbed into the Russian Empire, where it remained until the end of the First World War. For a very brief period of time, after the First World War, Ukraine was technically an independent state, but was reabsorbed, as it were, into the Soviet Union upon the formation of the Soviet Union in 1922, where it would remain until 1991. Of course, in 1991, with the collapse of the Soviet Union, Ukraine declared its independence, a move, I would add, by the way, which was overwhelmingly supported by everyone in Ukraine, whether ethno-linguistically Ukrainian or ethno-linguistically Russian. And one should not overlook that fact. But again, the map is simply to orient our viewers and our participants as to where we are on the face of the earth. B.J. Pendry knows very well, my students know very well, that one cannot study the history of any people or place without knowing where one is. And as a consequence, I think familiarization with where Ukraine is and what it looks like is important to this discussion. We have yet another map here. This is simply a political map of Ukraine, the previous one having been primarily topographical. And what I like about this map for the purpose of instructing our viewers is that if one looks at the bottom of that map, one will see the Crimean Peninsula. This was part of Ukraine, which, of course, was invaded, occupied, and subsequently annexed by Russia in 2014, the last time Russia invaded Ukraine. I've often said to my students and to some of the folks with whom I work that, not being a diplomat, I can call this what it is, what it was in 2014. It was an invasion and an illegal annexation of Crimea. One understands perfectly well the diplomatic niceties which are always involved in such discussions at a public level. But it is important for us as educators, it seems to me, to call these things what they are. And what happened in 2014 was an invasion. And what is happening now, of course, is an invasion as well, no matter what the Russians call it. If one looks at the lower right-hand corner of that map, one will see another portion of Ukraine, which was also invaded and occupied in 2014, part of the geographic region of Ukraine called the Donbas. That shaded area on the map is that part of the Donbas which was occupied by Russian forces and their separatist colleagues since 2014. I think it is important, Marty, to remember that there has been a war in Ukraine ongoing since 2014. Ukraine has been at war with Russia for 8 years. The war never stopped. And indeed, on two occasions, in 2014 and in 2016, if I recall correctly, the Ukrainians were on the verge of winning it. And on both of those occasions, Russian regular forces intervened to reverse the Ukrainian military momentum. So Russian military forces have been actively involved in Ukraine in this war since 2015 at least. And to say otherwise is to ignore the reality of the facts on the ground. If one looks at this next illustration, of course, we see an administrative map of Ukraine. This shows the division of the country into its regional subdivisions. These are called oblasts in Ukrainian, as they are in Russian. And one hears a lot of press commentary and sees a lot of press commentary and media commentary about the regions of Luhansk and Donetsk. This is that portion of Ukraine in the southeastern portion of the country. They formed the bulk of that region called the Donbas. And most of the major fighting, especially in the last 10 days, has been in that part of Ukraine where we have the oblasts of Donetsk and Luhansk. It is worth noting, I think, that the oblasts don't have the same relation to the central government as states would here in the United States, for example, or the states in Germany to the German government, for example. The oblasts are sort of executors of the will of the central government. Ukraine is a unitary state, so that the oblasts have only those regional prerogatives which are delegated to them by the central government. Nevertheless, of course, they are that constituent element of the Ukrainian state, which features so prominently now in the news coverage of this war. It's also worth pointing out, by the way, given events in recent days, the country of Moldova on this particular map. There's been some activity in Moldova for the last several days, which appears to be false flag operations being executed by the Russian intelligence service, the FSB, to destabilize Moldova. It remains to be seen whether or not that will actually occur. But that's been those false flag, what appear to be false flag operations, have been ongoing now for about the last 72 hours. And again, these maps are simply to help orient our audience. This map, I think, is very, very useful. Ukraine is a very, very complex country, and historically has always been. It has never been solely ethno-linguistically Ukrainian, and it has most certainly never been solely ethno-linguistically Russian. Over the course of many centuries, various ethno-linguistic populations have lived side by side, not always peacefully, has to be admitted, but side by side in that region of the world that we now call Ukraine. And if one looks at this map, one can see that there's a general progression from west to east between a ethno-linguistic Ukrainian majority to an ethno-linguistic Russian majority. There is, of course, an overlap between language and ethnicity. We can have Ukrainians who are ethnically Ukrainian but whose mother tongue is Russian. And we can have Ukrainians who are ethnically Russian but whose mother tongue is Ukrainian. A very good case in point, for example, is the current president of Ukraine, President Zelensky. His mother tongue is Russian. Ukrainian is his second language, and he comes from that part of Ukraine, which has been under attack since the 24th of February of this year. So he makes it a point, and rightly so, and I think very, very pointedly so, to address the Russians in their own tongue when he addresses them. And I think that's a very effective way of getting the message to them, to the extent that they can still receive messages from the outside world. If one looks at that map, of course, you can see also that there are other populations as well. There is a fairly significant Carpathian Ukrainian population, which is slightly different ethno-linguistically from Ukrainians as a whole. There's a Romanian-speaking minority, a Hungarian-speaking minority, and so on. So this map is useful simply in illustrating this ethno-linguistic complexity of the country. I would point out that a very interesting event has occurred, or transition has occurred, I guess I should say, since the invasion began, and that is, if there was never, I was saying this to my students the other day, if there was never Ukrainian national identity before the 24th of February, 2022, there is now. There has been a remarkable degree of support for the Ukrainian government among ethno-linguistic Russian Ukrainians. All the evidence that I have seen indicates that they are equally as supportive of the Ukrainian government, on the whole, as are their ethno-linguistic Ukrainian compatriots. I have heard of, I haven't seen it, but I've heard of a video that went viral of two ethnically Russian Ukrainian soldiers who, after they destroyed a Russian tank, went on a cursing spree in Russian, that this video went viral. I haven't seen it, but if any of our viewers know about it, send it to me. I'd like to see it. It'd be interesting to see. I've only read about it, so I don't use social media, I'm afraid, so a lot of that stuff gets by me. But I think this map is useful to our audience by way of illustrating the complexity, the very real complexity and genuine complexity of Ukraine. It's by no means monolithic, nor has it ever been. But as I said a moment ago, if there was not a Ukrainian national identity before this invasion began, I think it's safe to argue that there is now. And there has been, in fact, for many generations. This map simply illustrates the disposition of Russian forces before the invasion began. No doubt many of our members of our audience who have been following these events noticed over the course of last year, from the spring of last year through the end of the year, the movement of massive numbers of Russian troops to the borders of Ukraine, including into and along the border of Ukraine in Belarus. These deployments were always described as exercises. Alarm grew over the course of the whole year, 2021. As these exercises were carried out, there was a series in the spring, There was another series in the summer. And then as one went into the fall of last year, the troops essentially remained where they were with all the equipment that they'd brought to these exercises, and they never withdrew. It became really ominous for some of the researchers with whom I'm working in my NATO SAS 163 group as the Russians began to forward deploy field hospitals and that sort of thing, as well as lots of live ammunition. One typically doesn't use live ammunition on a large scale on military exercises, though, of course, one can. And as those deployments began to be made, particularly of field hospitals, the alarm bells began to ring across any number of groups with whom I have some contact in the work that I do and within my SAS 163 as well. And again, this map is simply to illustrate those dispositions. Here, of course, we see a map that shows the status of the invasion as of the 28th of February. That would have been 4 days in. And I included this slide in the slide deck to show by way of dramatic contrast, what has happened since this point in time, the 28th of February. If one looks at the map there, one can see very large areas of Ukraine which were occupied. And which were being fought over, particularly in the north and the northeast, as well as in the far south and the southeast. And as regards the north and the northeast, of course, we have the city of Kiev, which is the capital of the country. And if you look at this next illustration, this is a situation map as of the 25th of this month. And if one looks at the north and the northeastern part of the country, one sees very clearly that all those Russian troops are gone. The Ukrainian armed forces did a remarkable job, truly remarkable, of defeating these Russian forces. The Russian forces had their own problems with, as I'm sure many of our viewers know, with logistics and command and control problems and low morale and so on. But one should never forget that it was Ukrainian resistance which drove them out. One should also not forget that this Ukrainian resistance has been what it has been, not least because Ukrainian armed forces have been trained by NATO countries since 2014. There was a very interesting op-ed in the Wall Street Journal several days ago about that. And I think we forget that sometimes. There has been NATO support for the armed forces of Ukraine and for the Ukrainian government as well since 2014. And they have quite evidently learned their lessons very, very well. And of course, they have their own battlefield experience as well. I mean, as I said a moment ago, they've been at war since 2014. As we have all been saying in recent days especially, we are expecting a very, very large Russian ground offensive in the southeast of the country, there in the Donbass. And it remains to be seen how long that will go on and to what end it will lead. Nevertheless, all the indications continue to be that there's going to be a major Russian ground offensive. I, for one, as a military historian, would not anticipate a sort of surprise launching of this thing. I think it's going to continue to be what it already is, which is to say a gradual escalation of conventional warfare and mass against the Ukrainians. Which, of course, they're not sitting back and waiting on, obviously. But I don't think we're going to see a dramatic escalation from one day to the next in terms of Russian military activity. I would assume that there's going to be a steady building up of combat capability on the part of the Russians and greater numbers as well. But there's a dramatic difference between that map and the one we were just looking at. This then takes us into the reaction of the Western countries to this war. One of Vladimir Putin's arguments in launching this invasion has been the mantra of NATO expansion since 1989 to the east, and the threat, as he sees it, of Ukrainian membership in NATO. Throughout the Cold War, it has to be remembered from 1947 to 1989 and 90, there was a Russian Empire in the eastern half of the continent of Europe. We called it the Soviet bloc. We called it the Eastern bloc. We called it the Communist bloc. This was a Soviet empire, in point of fact, at a functional level. All of the governments of Cold War Europe on the eastern side of the Iron Curtain, they were all of them installed by the Soviet Union, either immediately after the war, World War II, or within a few years of the end of the Second World War. And they were maintained in power to no little degree through the influence of the Soviet Union. This was a Soviet empire on the eastern half of the continent of Europe. And when the Soviet Union began to weaken and ultimately collapse, that empire went with it. Now, we've all heard that Vladimir Putin has said, and he did in fact say it, that in his view, the collapse of the Soviet Union was the greatest geopolitical catastrophe of the 20th century. I think he actually believes that. There's no question but that that part of Europe which had been dominated by the Soviet Union since the end of the Second World War was lost to Russia. And of course, there's no question but that NATO expanded into that space. If one looks at this next map, one can see that very clearly. Those parts of Europe that had been under the Soviet domination throughout the Cold War end up becoming part of either the European Union or NATO or both. There's a great deal of overlap between those two international organizations. In some cases, countries are members of both the EU and NATO. In other cases, they're in NATO but not the EU. And in other cases still, they're in the EU but not NATO. But again, this map clearly shows us that NATO expanded into that space because the countries which are in that part of Europe wanted to be in NATO. The reason why they wanted to be in NATO was precisely because of their experience with Soviet domination after the Second World War. And they knew that membership in NATO could offer them protection at a military level, at a physical level. And membership in the European Union could offer them economic prosperity and political solidarity that they would benefit from. As we often say, this is not rocket science. These countries wanted in NATO and or the European Union because it was to their benefit to be members of NATO and the European Union. And Russian propaganda notwithstanding, NATO is in fact a defensive alliance. It is not an offensive alliance. And I feel very confident in saying that were any country in NATO to decide to launch a war of aggression against Russia, there'd be no support for it, except perhaps in the deluded mind of whatever government would want to do that in NATO. There would not be consensus in NATO for anything like that. I really don't believe that. I really believe that that would not be the case. The very fact that there is such dramatic NATO solidarity in the face of this war of aggression is, to me, remarkable. In light of the recent difficulties which NATO experienced, those, in fact, are not that new. NATO has been troubled from time to time over the course of its existence. France very famously withdrew from NATO in 1966 during the presidency of President de Gaulle, later to come back to NATO. There were very troubled transatlantic relations in the 1980s. So trouble within NATO is not something which is new. What I think is new in more recent years has been the very, very deep strain and the very real feeling of unease on the part of European NATO powers that American leadership could no longer be counted on. And that's a very, very serious divide which President Putin in Russia took advantage of. To the degree to which NATO is weakened, to the degree to which the European Union is weakened, to that same degree, Russia benefits. And that is the sort of simple explanation for what we often now call hybrid warfare, this full-spectrum conflict which runs from disinformation and propaganda campaigns through cybernetic attacks on infrastructure, whether it's pipelines or communications networks or food distribution systems, through what is now called kinetic warfare, where there are bombs and bullets and missiles and tanks and so on. That hybrid warfare, in its current guise, is something which benefits Russia enormously at a strategic level. And to the degree to which hybrid warfare can or has succeeded in recent years in dividing the transatlantic partners, in unsettling the European Union, in unsettling the NATO members in Europe, to that same extent, Russia has benefited. And as this war began, there were a great many people, as I'm sure many of our audience members know, that felt that there would not be NATO solidarity in the face of this aggression, much less EU solidarity. And I think I should love to be a fly on the wall of the Kremlin to know what kind of reaction Vladimir Putin has had to this solidarity to this point. American leadership has shown itself, in my estimation, to be remarkable to this point, not only in forging a consensus among the NATO countries, but in helping foster a consensus within the European Union as well. Though, of course, the European Union makes its own decisions, right? But that sort of dual solidarity on the part of both NATO and the European Union, to me as a historian of these events, is a remarkable demonstration of American leadership and alliance cohesion as well, I would say.
Dr. Otto, if you would allow a question to interject that's very relevant to exactly what you're talking about. Brandon Robinson, class of 05, mm-hmm. our friend who's mm-hmm. also a member of our WCU Foundation Board in Durham, North Carolina, asks, Dr. Dorondo, so great to attend a lecture of yours again. Could you speak more broadly about how this war changes Europeans' calculus with regard to NATO and collective security? So you're speaking to that point, and so mm-hmm. I wonder if you could, at Brandon's request, speak a little bit more broadly about how Europeans are thinking about that relationship within NATO.
I'd be delighted to address that question. I just came out of a meeting 2 hours ago, an hour and a half ago, of one of the subgroups of SAS 163, where we were talking about that specific issue. Particularly in the realm of energy security, but also within the larger context of changing European perceptions. One can never guarantee that the changed attitude of Europe's NATO, NATO's European members and the members of the European Union will be a permanent change of attitude. That simply cannot be guaranteed. But the degree to which there has been a unified response on the part of NATO and the European Union leads me to hope that this change of attitude, economic, military, geopolitical, and so on, towards Russia, by all of the countries of Europe, will be permanent. I certainly hope it will be permanent. The example that I always use since the invasion began, of course, has been Germany. My particular remit within the work that I'm doing for NATO has to do with political and historical analysis of the German position regarding all of these issues, and to a somewhat lesser extent, Austria as part of German-speaking Europe. And as many of our audience members know, there was a very dramatic speech delivered by the German Chancellor on the 27th of February to the German Bundestag, the parliament, in which he said, Europe is undergoing a turn of the age, a Zeitenwende. And in this speech, he announced not only a huge increase in German military defense spending, which the United States, for one, has been calling for years, right, regardless of administration. He not only announced that, and not only just for a 1 year, but a what he hopes will be, according to his speech, a permanent increase in German military spending. Not only did he do that, which I have to say shocked me. I did not anticipate it. And it shocked a great many other people too, I can assure you. But he also pledged in that same speech now actively to support Ukraine with lethal military assistance, in which case Germany had been lagging behind many other European countries. Estonia, for example, had donated more lethal military assistance to Ukraine until the 27th of February, then had Germany. Now, there's still been some criticism of Germany since the 27th of February by the other members of NATO, particularly to Germany's east, but also from the governments of Great Britain and France and some other NATO members as well, to the extent that Germany has not yet sort of come through with these promises. Yesterday, over the course of the last 48 hours, the German Defense Ministry formally announced at a meeting at Ramstein Air Base in Germany, chaired by Secretary Austin, that Germany would now begin to provide heavy weaponry to Ukraine. Heavy weaponry is legally defined in the Conventional Forces in Europe Treaty as things, as military equipment such as tanks, heavy armored vehicles, artillery above a certain caliber, combat aircraft, that sort of thing. And Germany has now formally announced that it will now begin to provide heavy weaponry to the Ukrainians, the first shipment of which is supposed to be a shipment of 50 self-propelled anti-aircraft systems. Now, again, you know, one always has to look at the details, right? Regardless of which country is providing support. You know, will there be maintenance provided? Well, you know, what are the logistics of this delivery look like? Is there sufficient ammunition? Can the Ukrainians be trained on the equipment rapidly enough? You know, that's a common concern for any country, including the United States, providing this sort of support for Ukraine. But for the Germans to make these kinds of decisions in so dramatic a fashion leads me to hope that this change of attitude will be permanent. A lingering concern I have, of course, regarding Europe and Russia and Germany and Russia, however, remains the economic concern. Europe is much more heavily dependent on Russian hydrocarbon exports than is, of course, the United States. This is a common place to assert now. A lot of people are aware of that now. But the dependency on Russia is really remarkable in some cases. Bulgaria, for example, depending on whose numbers you're looking at, imports between 70 and 90% of all of its natural gas from Russia. In the case of Germany, as of the 24th of February, it was 55% of all natural gas imports into Germany came from Russia. Austria is very heavily dependent. Hungary is very heavily dependent on these hydrocarbon imports from Russia. And so in the long run, to the extent that Europe can successfully and permanently wean itself off of hydrocarbon imports from Russia, I think that would signal over the medium and long term the permanence of a European change of attitude. The military change can be done relatively quickly, right? That's simply a matter of spending and producing the necessary equipment and training the necessary troops, whether for Ukraine or for any of the individual NATO countries. This longer-term economic weaning off of energy dependency on Russia is of, I think, greater import in that it would show us, I think, whether or not this change of European attitude will be permanent.
Can one assume that this Russian action that was announced, was it last night, turning off the spigot, so to speak, to Poland and Bulgaria, will have a dramatic economic impact on Europe, who one can assume that they'll have to go somewhere to find hydrocarbon, to find fuel, to find gas for their cars and heat for their homes?
They most certainly will. Europeans always already pay a much higher degree of their disposable income per capita on fuel of any kind than do we here in the United States. It's much higher in Europe and has traditionally been. Most of the natural gas imported to Germany, for example, is used for home heating and for electricity production or other industrial uses. Some of it goes to the chemical industry and so on. Some of it goes to fertilizer production as well. And so even before this war ever started, as early as last spring, there were natural gas heating crises from the UK to Poland and from Scandinavia to Italy as prices began to rise well before this war ever started. what is now happening, of course, and I'm not an economist, so you'd have to speak to an economist about this, but it is clearly the case that Russia's turning off the natural gas to Bulgaria and Poland is going to aggravate or exacerbate an already serious energy crisis for the whole of Europe. And the question then becomes, well, where do they get this natural gas to replace it, what the Russians are no longer sending? In the case of Poland, for example, I was just speaking to a Polish colleague in this meeting this afternoon who was saying that the new Baltic pipe, as it's called, from Poland to Norway will help offset what the Russians will no longer be sending to Poland in terms of natural gas and oil as well. That one pipeline doesn't carry both oil and natural gas. But the Poles, very wisely in retrospect, spent the last 8 years diversifying their energy sources so as to wean themselves off this dependency early, as did the Baltic states. Germany didn't. Germany made a conscious strategic decision to continue to invest in Russian hydrocarbons, oil and natural gas particularly, to a lesser extent coal, gambling that the Russian government under Putin would not want to kill the golden goose. And the German government was simply wrong. They were simply wrong about it. And to his credit, Chancellor Scholz has admitted this. But my concern remains, once the war ends, however it ends, will this change of attitude as regards energy security and energy dependency on Russia, will that change? And that remains to be seen. To the extent that that happens, I think that would indicate a long-term European change of attitude.
And Dr. Dorondo, we're starting to get a lot of questions that are coming through, and I want to make sure we have enough time to get mm-hmm. to those. Do you have a few more slides to go through?
Just a very few. This is a general slide showing the European gas pipeline infrastructure. And if you look at the top of that map, you'll see two multicolored pipelines. Those pipelines are the ones that you see here. That's the now infamous Nord Stream 2 pipeline that connects Russia with Germany. And that pipeline was a bone of contention throughout the previous administration and with the incoming Biden administration as well. That pipeline is now, at least for the time being, on hold. It's been completed. It was in the process of undergoing certification by the German certifying agency. The certification process is now stopped. The pipeline is there, of course, and it remains possible, of course, that it could be put into use at some future time. But that's the infamous sort of Nord Stream pipeline that we've been hearing so much about for the last several months. And then finally, the last slide, this is a useful slide, I think, as well. It's a slide depicting liquefied natural gas terminals in Europe. And one of the options for replacing Russian natural gas through pipelines would be to bring in liquefied natural gas from other parts of the world and then re-liquefying it and putting into the gas pipeline network for Europe. The German government is exploring a long-term contract with the country of Qatar, for example, to import liquefied natural gas. The United States has for years wanted to send LNG to Europe. The problem, of course, is that Germany doesn't have any LNG terminals, and so it'll take 2 or 3 years to build them. They could build floating terminals, which could be put online in about 3 or 4 months. I think it's Latvia or Lithuania is doing that very thing right now. So the Germans, you know, they have other options, but they're fast-tracking two LNG terminals now in the north of Germany, but the earliest they could be brought online would be in about 2 years. But there are other terminals, of course, and it's all a matter of infrastructure, getting the gas to where it needs to go. So those are the slides that I brought along today, and to the extent that the audience has questions, I'd be delighted to take more of them.
Okay. Well, great. Thank you, Dr. Dorondo, for an extremely interesting and enlightening presentation. You have made me want to get back in the classroom. You really have.
You're always welcome.
Okay. Thank you. Now, viewers, it's your turn. If you have any questions, as I mentioned, we're already getting some that are coming through, but if you have any questions or comments for Dr. Dorondo, please submit them using the chat feature on YouTube or Facebook, and we'll share those with him. And we'll go ahead and get started. All the way from Houston, Texas, class of 87, Glenn Harrell. What do you believe is Putin's true motivation for securing Ukraine into Russia? He obviously does not care about the people or infrastructure.
That's a great question. One always hazards to try to get into the mind of Vladimir Putin, I think. I don't claim to be an expert on the man personally, in terms of my research and so on. But I have taught Russian history here at Western for many years when I first began to teach here in the department. And I'm once again this semester teaching a Russian history course, coincidentally, as it turns out. But as I think it is safe to say that his motivations are mixed. He does, in fact, I believe, see himself as the fulfiller of a great destiny for his country, and I think for himself personally. I heard someone yesterday on a television program describe him as a would-be Frederick the Great, who, of course, was a German king, Prussian king. I would say, rather, he thinks of himself as a modern-day Peter the Great. In the 17th century, during the reigns of Peter the Great and his immediate successors, Russia began that process of what we today would describe as colonization of what is today eastern and southern Ukraine, and the establishment of that that area of the Russian Empire called Novorossiya. And that same word has been used since 2014 to describe in Russian an imagined Russian possession of eastern and southern Ukraine all the way to the borders of Moldova. They used exactly the same word that was used in the 17th and 18th centuries. So I think to a certain extent he sees himself as that, the fulfiller of a great destiny for his country and himself. He also clearly does not believe that the Ukrainians are a separate people. He clearly does not believe it's a separate country. I had the dubious pleasure to read his 5,000-word essay that he wrote last July, or that was had his byline on it. And if one reads that essay, and it's readily available in English, one can clearly see that he does not think, and he says it as much, that the Ukrainians are not a separate people, and Ukraine is not a separate country. In that essay, he says, among many other things, that Ukraine can only have a sovereign existence within the framework of Russia. So I think that's part of his motivation as well, to reunite, as it were, in his eyes, what he sees as a people and a part of Russia which were unfairly taken away. He very famously and recently blamed Vladimir Lenin for that. When Vladimir Lenin's Soviet constitution came into force in 1922. He's blamed a great many people and a great many events. One can take one's pick, I think. So in part, it's the sort of, you know, messianic motivation, historic messianism, I guess. Part of it is his misinterpretation, in my view, of Ukrainian history, a very bad misinterpretation. And then part of it's a geopolitical desire to resurrect the power and the might of what used to be the Soviet Union. Not to recreate the Soviet Union. He doesn't want that. What I think he wants, to that extent, what I think he wants is the power and the respect, international respectability that went with being the Soviet Union. I think he would very much like to have that. Absolutely.
Sure. Great. Thank you. Here's another question for you. Alex Simkis, class of 18. Dr. Dorondo, loved your class back in college. Tell the university to please keep you on these podcasts and video streams. You are passionate about this subject, and it shows.
Thank you. That's very gracious. Thank you.
Certainly. From English professor emeritus, Terry Nienhuis. Terry, thanks for tuning in this evening. I had Terry for an English Lit class way back when, 1982, so it's been a few years. Terry's question is, how realistic is the fear of nuclear warfare in this situation?
That's a terrifically important question. Much of my research with U.S. Strategic Command's Academic Alliance, which is a sort of a separate undertaking from the stuff I'm doing with NATO, has to do with the sort of twins, the strategic twins called deterrence and assurance. And I don't look at it from a policy analyst point of view, but rather from the historical perspective. Anytime, I was saying to someone just yesterday, in fact, anytime a country that possesses nuclear weapons threatens to use them, one has to take that seriously. One can never simply dismiss it as mere rhetoric. One can never simply dismiss it as mere saber rattling. particularly in light of Russia's public military doctrine. Many of our viewers have no doubt heard the phrase escalate to de-escalate. This phrase does not exist in the Russian documents, but the principle is that if Russia were to be in a war for Russia's national existence, and if it felt so badly threatened that it needed to employ nuclear weapons, it would do so. Typically of the kind that we call non-strategic nuclear weapons. They're often called tactical nuclear weapons, which I think is an unfortunate turn of phrase. Nevertheless, use these nuclear weapons at a local level to score an operational victory and so intimidate one's enemies that they will not dare to escalate from there, that they will withdraw, de-escalate, as it were. There have been very many threats issued by President Putin and by his foreign secretary, Sergei Lavrov, since the war began, that Russia could resort to nuclear weapons. And Sergei Lavrov said, made reference to World War III the day before yesterday, and how serious that threat is and so on. We simply cannot dismiss that as mere rhetoric. But I can say with absolute certainty, having seen this with my own eyes, that U.S. Strategic Command, headquartered at Offutt Air Force Base, is watching these developments, this particular series of issues, literally 24 hours a day. I can say that with absolute certainty. And I have seen no indication in any of the public information which I see that would lead me to think that the Russians are doing anything more at this moment than simply talking and issuing threats, probably to do precisely what is occurring in many places, that is to say, causing alarm.
Sure.
In the hope that by causing sufficient alarm, there could be fractures in NATO's solidarity, the European Union solidarity, and so on. So I see nothing in the public source material that I see, and I see some things that others might not, that would lead me to think that it's anything but rhetoric at this moment.
Okay, very good. Thank you. Looks like we have a fan club started for you here. Here's another comment and question from Jessica Gerard, class of 06. Hi, Dr. Dorondo. It's great to participate in one of your lectures again, especially with Ben Pendry and Brandon Robinson in the room. We have a second fan club started here. While it's clear that the latest invasion was the result of political, social, and economic tensions that have been building over the years, are there other motivating factors?
On Russia's part?
Yes.
I think there is one that's worth noting. And by the way, these are great questions. The one from Terry Nine, I assume, I've not seen for many years. Terry, if you're still with us, it's great to hear from you again, and Ms. Girard as well. I think there's another interesting motivation that's worth taking note of, and that is Russia is in the midst, and has been now for years, it's in the midst of a very well-known and widely recognized demographic decline. The current population, as I said at the outset, is about 146 million. But the life expectancy in Russia is dropping among that part of the population which is most important to Vladimir Putin, and that is white ethno-linguistic Russians. And it would seem to me very difficult historically to be a great power, much less a superpower, if one's population is in decline. Now, obviously, that's a long-term prospect. And I think that I have to believe that that causes concern within the Russian government for the long-term evolution of the Russian state and for President Putin's legacy as well. You know, does he want to be the leader of a state which is in demographic decline? Does he want to be the new sick man of Europe, a phrase that emerged in the 19th century as regards Turkey? You know, is that Russia now? I don't know that I've ever heard him say that or evince that apprehension. But I have to think that he knows enough history, and I believe he probably does, to know that phrase. Russia's already China's junior partner in the sort of great you know, international league of autocrats and dictators. I don't think he wants to continue to be. I don't think he wants to become more Xi Jinping's junior partner. And so I think that's part of his motivation as well, sort of to physically assert, as it were, this Russian greatness. But the cost is enormous. He's generating exactly the response that he said he did not want at the outset. Economic sanctions of an unprecedented sort, which are, of course, long-term. They have only a long-term effect, obviously. But economic sanctions, increased defense spending in Germany, of all places, a revivified transatlantic relationship, a revivified American leadership in NATO, EU solidarity, that never happens. The EU is never united on anything. At a practical level, I'm not trying to be, you know, facetious about it. It's very difficult to get the EU to do anything. Their COVID response was remarkable in its cohesion. And at the moment, both NATO and EU, I wouldn't say they're in lockstep, because Hungary's a NATO member, and the government of Hungary's, the leader of Hungary, Viktor Orban, is a fan of President Putin. I wouldn't ever use the phrase lockstep, but I keep using this word solidarity. I think it's actual and real. And this is exactly what he did not want. Most dramatically, the Finns and the Swedes are now actively considering NATO membership. Through the history of the Cold War, Sweden was neutral. Finland was neutral since 1940. And now both of these countries are actively seeking NATO membership. It looks like it's going to happen perhaps as early as June, though nothing happens until it happens. Right. That never happened in the Cold War. Right. So his actions are generating all the wrong kinds of responses from his perspective, it seems to me. Yeah. And he's got to be looking over his shoulder at Beijing as well.
Sure. Glad you addressed the Finland. Selena Woods, class of 85, classmate of mine from Ohio, asked the question, can you discuss Finland's recent suggestions on joining NATO?
Yes.
You just addressed that.
One of the great commentators on this whole issue since the buildup of Russian forces began and since the war has begun is the former Allied Supreme Commander of NATO, Admiral James Stavridis. He's on TV quite frequently. Just wrote a terrific novel, 2034, co-authored a novel. I recommend everybody read it. It's terrifically good. I forget the subtitle of it. But he says fairly frequently in one version or another that if Finland and Sweden asked to join NATO on Wednesday, they'd be in by Friday. It wouldn't happen precisely that fast, but I have no doubt that if Finland and Sweden make that decision to join NATO and formally apply, they'll be in very short order. That's a historically staggering change for those two countries.
Sure.
When the military history of this war is written, do you believe that the Crimean conflict and the war there will be seen as part and parcel of the war on Ukraine? As in, do you believe that was a necessary move for President Putin? He had to have that strategic arm off the coast of Russia to control and be able to deploy forces.
That's a great question.
Into the south end of Ukraine.
That's a terrifically good question. There's no question but that Crimea has served as a kind of a launching pad for this invasion. And it's no secret to say that Russian forces, among those places where they've been most successful, has been in that part of Ukraine immediately to the north and the east of Crimea. Russian forces have not been nearly so successful to the north and the west of Crimea, except for the city of Kherson, which they have occupied. And it's the only major Ukrainian city to date that they have occupied, the only major city. So Crimea was absolutely critical to any success that's going to be had in the south and in the southeast, no question about it. And that land bridge that we keep hearing about, that strip of Ukrainian territory from the Donbass to Crimea, the only thing that keeps that now from being solidified, fully solidified, is the continuing Ukrainian resistance in Mariupol. Mm. Yeah.
Okay, I think we have time for one more question. We have about one more minute in our hour. This is from Jordan Glass, class of 09. Dr. Dorondo, thank you for doing this. Germany increasing its military spending and production. Could this ignite an old rivalry with Russia and worry any other European allies?
That's also a very, very good question. I've often pointed out in my research task group, my NATO research task group, that instances of Russian-German cooperation are at least as frequent as Russian-German hostility, if you look at it historically. In those instances where there has been open hostility and war, those instances have been spectacularly bad for one side or the other or for both. There's no question about that. But if one looks at Russian-German relations in the longer historical perspective over the course of 200 or 250 years, one sees that very frequently Russia and Germany in Germany's earlier forms have cooperated. And when they have cooperated, that's been at the expense of all of the countries that are between Germany and Russia. I think it goes far too far to say that Germany in NATO in 2022 is a country which would have designs on any of its neighbors to the east. I think that's radically too far. But the fact that Germany, until this month, had insisted on maintaining extraordinarily close and deep economic ties with Russia, in spite of all of the behavior of the Russian government since 2008, particularly, when Georgia was invaded, that makes me think about this much longer historical record. When there is Russian-German cooperation, it often, not every time, but it often goes at the expense or occurs at the expense of those countries which lie between the Baltic and the Black Seas. Again, I don't anticipate a repetition of that in the near term. But I don't think Germany's increasing its defense spending in anything, those kinds of things now should be perceived as an immediate threat to any of Germany's neighbors to the east at this point. I don't see it.
All right, great. Thank you. Well, folks, we're out of time this evening. That hour just really flew by, didn't it, Ben? It sure did.
It really did.
Yeah. Dr. Dorondo, thank you so much for offering your historical, political expertise this evening. I can't thank you enough.
It's been my pleasure, Marty. Thank you very much indeed.
Ben Pendry, thank you so much for being here this evening.
Thank you, Marty. Thank you, Dr.
Dorondo. TJ, thank you.
Yeah. Also want to thank some other folks behind the scenes. Alex Childress is here behind the scenes helping us out. Sam Wallace, want to thank them from WCU's communication and marketing team, as well as James Hogan and Bo Busby from the Office of Alumni Engagement for all their hard work and excellent work behind the scenes this evening as well. And thanks to you, the viewers, for being here this evening. We appreciate it, and we look forward to seeing you all back in Cullowhee again one day soon. Everyone, have a great night. Thank you.